I'm not going to speak to you anything about what you already know of breast milk. I'm sure that you all know the breast milk is the best, and you know there are so many reasons. I'm sure that you all know about it. So probably I probably will be talking about something that you know of human milk. And most of my topic is actually going to be what you really don't know of human milk. So that is why I said from known to unknown science of human milk. Right, let me start this topic with human milk is magical. I don't know whether you really know, a newborn ingests 10 to the power 8 maternal cells a day. With 80% being maternal, it also has 32 factors and 5 cell types and 42 factors. Cell types predominantly macro, but it has T lymphocytes, B lymphocytes, neutrophils, and recently they found stem cells. What you see in the background here is actually the stem cells that you see in breast milk. So you see that the research is now going on whether you can extract stem cells from human breast milk. So that means there are so much of stem cells in the human breast milk. So there are cells which are active and functioning cells. And the other important thing I just thought to let you know is that there are a lot of myths that we were having in our minds. Number one, we thought that the human milk is sterile. But now there is ample evidence that human milk is not sterile. And there is now what you call human milk microbiota. There are thousands and thousands of bacteria, not thousands, many millions of bacteria in the human breast milk. But all these bacteria, what is there in breast milk is actually absolutely harmless. They are non-pathogenic common cell bacteria that you get in human milk. Majority coming from the breast milk and some coming from the areola of the nipple. Of the mother. When we thought, okay, human milk is not sterile, but when the baby is born, the gut is sterile. But there are studies had shown that the newborn gut is also not sterile. So now they believe probably the human gut colonization may be initiated in utero by distinct microbial communities in the placenta and amniotic fluid in the mother. And then we think a baby in utero is in a sterile environment and safe. But now there's a lot of new evidence coming up to say that the newborn is not sterile inside uterus as well. The placenta harbors a unique microbiome. And this microbiome is also very important because now the people found that dysbiosis, that if you really disturb the placental microbiome, you might get premature delivery, that might cause premature deliveries. And some of the premature deliveries is now related to this, the so-called placental microbiome dysbiosis. That means if you have a pathological organisms or pathogenic organisms in the gut, in the placenta, then it might cause what you call preterm deliveries. And there's a very interesting phenomena they have observed. Now the placenta, the placental bacteria is not the mother's gut microbiota. The placental microbe is actually, microbiome is actually coming from the mother's mouth. The oral microbiota. So if the mother is having poor oral hygiene, and there are pathogenic bacteria in the mouth, that might lead to premature delivery of the baby because there is the so-called placental dysmicrobiosis. So these are the recent things that we have come to know. Now this is about the human milk microbiome. I told you it forms 40% of the gut microbiota, 30% from the milk, and the rest is from the areola of the skin. And more than 500 species, all of them are essentially non-pathogenic. That's the important point. And the majority of them belong to Firmicutes genera. Now, second point is human milk is dynamic. It is constantly changing. It's a living fluid. It changes with the varying demands of the baby. We know, all know that we have colostrum. They are in the first few days of life. Then 2 days to 2 weeks, we have transitional milk. And after 2 weeks, we have what you call mature breast milk. Now, then you have what you call foremilk and hind milk. The first part of milk when you are giving the, when you are feeding the baby, the first part of the breast milk is different to the second part. Then you have preterm milk versus term milk. When a baby is born prematurely or preterm baby delivery, the mother's milk, mother also produces breast milk, but that milk is little different to the term milk. So we will discuss little bit about that. Now, colostrum. We all know colostrum is there for baby mainly to provide immunity, protection. So it has very high content of lysozyme, very high content of lactoferrin, because bacteria, lactoferrin itself is actually to a certain degree the bacteria is idle. And it has a lot of IgA in comparison to the mature breast milk. And colostrum also is high in protein because baby needs growth, and also fat soluble vitamins, minerals and immunoglobulins. All these things are there to provide a right environment for the baby to protect him from infection. Then 2 days to 2 weeks, we have what you call transitional milk. The important thing about the transitional milk is it has very high content of fat, very high content of fat. Right, can you all see? Right, yes, now, sir. Okay. Now, why is colostrum so important? You see this slide, it's so important. Now, gut transformation after birth. Now, this is the first part of the slide. This thing is fetus at birth. You can see that the cell wall is very thin and in very little cell enzyme activity. Then the lamina propria is also less cellular, and you can see that it's all thinner, and even the muscle cell layer was very thin. You see, when you start giving breastfeeding, within 2 to 3 hours that you get start proliferating of epithelium, all subclass of enterocytes are there, and complete differentiation within 3 to 4 hours after giving the first breastfeed. So one may argue this may not be true, because any baby may be after 2-3 hours after birth, these changes are there. So that is probably one argument. Now, this is just to show you that is not true. Now, here you see that they have fed the newborns after birth with human milk, which is 57 days old, and human milk, which is only 3 days old. And you can see this is the enterocyte proliferation. So you can see the enterocyte proliferation is remarkably higher in babies where the 3 day old breast milk is given. So that means this is the colostrum which got these changes, not because of just the milk or anything else. So this is what the beauty of breast milk. Now, foremilk and hind milk. We all know that the foremilk is watery. It has a lot of sugar and less proteins and fat and less energy. Whereas hind milk is thick and white, less sugar, but it is very rich in proteins and fat, provides more energy. Now, one could argue, why do you want to have that? You can have the same milk throughout. No, that is what when you are giving formula, which you are giving the same milk throughout. Why do you want to have a foam milk which is slowly becoming hind milk? It's a very slow process. When the baby starts sucking, slowly the sugar content goes down and then the milk getting richer and richer with proteins and fats. So the reason being, because it's a newborn, this is a very new experience. So in case if the baby is sort of, you know, doesn't like the milk, when you are giving foam milk, which is watery, very easy to swallow, it has a lot of sugar, it is very tasty, so that it's very palatable to the child, he goes on drinking. When he goes on drinking, the nature knows now the child is now drinking. So without this knowledge, the sugar level will come back down and the milk becomes thicker and thicker with fat and proteins. So that is how they are so beautifully the nature is doing the whole stuff. Now the third part is actually term versus preterm called baby. Now you see the term baby, preterm baby and term baby more than the same amount of calories, but the protein content is pretty high in preterm babies because preterm baby needs to grow fast. The fat content is same, carbohydrate content is little lower, but see the micronutrient and the solutes. The calcium is more or less the same, but the iron content is pretty high, almost double. And the sodium content is very high. You have 248 milligrams per 1 liter. Zinc is also very high. Then the vitamins also very high. So that means the preterm baby needs them more than a term baby. That is why preterm babies we give vitamin supplementation earlier. So the nature knew about it. And nature knew that the normal milk is not suitable for a newborn baby because newborn babies need more sodium. Now you see in theory, when it's a new preterm baby is born, the kidneys are immature. So what would you expect? You expect the kidney cannot conserve, cannot exceed these things, metabolites. So that you expect this solute overloading inside the body. But when they studied, they found something different. They found that the newborn kidney cannot conserve solutes. So they lose sodium, they lose potassium, so that has to be replaced. So nature knew about it long before we came to know that the baby's kidney actually cannot conserve electrolytes. So that is why when the baby is born prematurely, that mother will have very high content of sodium and potassium in the breast milk. Now this is another very interesting slide to show you. I just showed you just now, but you see this is a standard formula feed to be given for preterm babies. See the content of sodium, 1217. But preterm breast milk only 248. See the iron, 12. Sodium, 291. Zinc, 10 milligrams. So why they are so much? That is because the formula fit babies, you have to put that much of electrolytes, you have to put that much of micronutrient because the bioavailability is not like breast milk. So that is why they have this higher content of electrolytes and micronutrients. Now this is another very interesting study that they found that if you are giving breastfeeding, the excessive weight gain over a month is roughly about 2 grams. Normally that means they are growing beautifully along the line. If you give breastfeeding plus formula feed, the minimum weight gain, excess weight gain is about 37 grams a month. If you give formula milk from the bottle, it's going to be 71 grams, more than 71 grams, excessive weight gain. Now this is the surprising part. If you give breast milk using only the bottle without giving the breast, the weight gain is very excessive. It's about 89 grams. So this is why we should discourage mothers to use bottle when they are giving breast milk. So what is the reason? Can anybody think about it? That is because when we are giving breastfeeding, when we give the breast to the baby decides how much to drink. It's under control by the baby. Whereas when you give breast milk using the bottle, it's the mother who decides how much the child should drink. she put about 6 ounces and give the baby till the baby, and it's sweeter than the formula feed. So the baby goes on gulping. So baby is taking excess breast milk if you are giving the bottle, because the limiting factor is the mother but not the baby. Whereas when you are giving the breast, baby decide how much I should take. That is why when you are giving breast milk using the bottle, you get obesity. Now this is the composition of breast milk. You can see if you take cow's milk, one component is missing. If you get the standard formula milk, that there is one component missing. If you get human breast milk, there is a bigger chunk, and that is called oligosaccharides. So you have lactose, sugar, you have fat, you have proteins, but in addition to that, you have what you call oligosaccharides, 10 to 15 grams per liter. That is the third highest content next to fat, more than proteins. So we have a lot of questions. So we just go now one by one. Proteins. The human milk protein is actually, you have only 0.9 grams per 100 ml. But if you take cow's milk, it is 3.5 grams per 100 ml. Now the modern day formula feeds also, majority of them are having low proteins, because they know the need to have higher content is wrong, then you get obesity. And the second type is the type of protein. You know that breast milk is whey predominant, whereas the cow's milk is casein predominant. And the breast milk or the formula human milk curds very softly and easily, whereas cow's milk it's a bit difficult. And also, interestingly, human milk is just not provide nutrition. It has lot of bioactive proteins like hormones, like enzymes, like various other immune factors, various other factors. So there are lot of bioactive proteins in the human milk. Now this is a very famous study. Everybody shows you this study, which is called the CHOP study. In this study, what they did was, when you give four breastfed babies and you measure the baby's height, weight, everything, and they found that the weight gain is, you can see, is marginal, the lowest in the start. Then when you give a formula feed with low proteins, eventually after 24 months, the weight gain is almost just like a breastfed baby. If you give standard formula where there is high content of proteins, you can see that their weight gain is much more, even their BMI is much more than what it should be. So in other words, if you give high protein in the first few months of life to a newborn baby, that it end up with obesity. These are the bioactive protein. There are so many. But I'm just giving you what factors are. You have antimicrobial factors, secretory IgA, lactoferrin, lysozymes, leukotrienes, bifidus factor, all kinds of things. And then you have hormones. You have prolactin, you have insulin, thyroid hormone, corticosteroids, calcitonin, parathormone, you name anything. Erythropoietin, they all are there in breast milk. And the growth factors, epidermal growth factor, nerve growth factors, insulin, IGF. Then enzyme transporters, digestive enzymes, and anti-inflammatory substances like tumor necrosis factor, interleukins, and prostaglandins, and so on and so forth. So you can see the human breast milk or the human milk is just not providing energy or nutrition and providing immunity to the baby. It has a lot of other factors which nothing else can match. This is the partial list, and this is actually the type of things I am just giving. I think it's the same slide, so I will just bypass it. Give one example. This is breast milk as an enzyme. I'm sure that you know what it is. It has what you call human milk lipase. So why do you want lipase? This is the beauty. The neonate, due to immaturity of pancreas, is unable to produce sufficient lipase to digest milk fat. So to compensate the deficit, Mother Nature produces acid stable. You see the beauty. Normally, the milk lipase from the pancreas is not that acid stable. But here, the mother produces acid stable, bile-stimulated lipase from the breast. Not from the parotid gland, from the breast. So that when the milk is traveling through the acidic stomach, lipase remains alive because it is acid stable until it gets into the duodenum, then it gets activated because it is bile stimulated. See the beauty of nature. So they not only that is given enzyme, but is given a perfect enzyme and the meticulous way that they have designed. Right. Now you see another example, a hormone. Human milk adiponectin. Adiponectin is actually a hormone produced by the adipose tissue of us, which enhances fatty acid metabolism, reduces inflammation, and also it reduces obesity. Now we know that the human milk also has adiponectin. So low levels as well with obesity. If you have low levels of adiponectin in the mother's breast milk, which can lead to obesity and diabetes in the child and dyslipidemia. Same with if you have low adiponectin in the human, us, that we will get obese and we get type diabetes and metabolic syndrome and so on. So the high levels of human milk adiponectin associated with lower infant weight in the first 6 months of life in breastfed babies, and also it may attenuate inflammatory process. Milk fat. I think I will just go. I'm sure that everybody knows about it. Human milk and the cow's milk has more or less the same thing. Only difference between the three is human milk, as I told you, it is very dynamic and alive. So therefore, it begins with, when we are feeding, begins with very low content of fat and slowly become higher. Whereas in cow's milk, when you are feeding, they are giving throughout the feeding that you are giving a constant amount. Right, digestibility. Of course, you can know that the breast milk is digested, fat is digested very easily. It has MCT oil, so easily absorbable, and also it has very high content of essential fatty acids and ARA and DHA, which is actually for, we all know that it is important for brain growth and the retinal development. Right, this is that other part I was talking about, the human milk. I discuss about proteins. The sugar, of course, we know nothing to discuss, and the lipids. Then I come to the important part that is called the human milk oligosaccharides. Now, what is this human milk oligosaccharides? Very important. So it contains 10 to 15 grams. I showed you this slide before. What are they? Well, we all know that human milk oligosaccharide, because human beings cannot digest oligosaccharide. Nobody can digest, neither a newborn baby or an adult cannot digest oligosaccharides. So everybody knows that it provides food for the gut microbes, yummy food. So that we all know. But the things that we don't know is that 10% of the 500 calories a lactating woman burns each day to make milk is spent synthesizing large amounts of different oligosaccharides which have no nutritive value at all. So is it another evolution failure? Because HMO do not nourish, so are they a waste of energy? So HMO must have some bioactive properties apart from being providing nutrition to the microbiome. So breast milk, the sole source of nourishment for the newborn, has been under intense selective pressure over millions of years of evolution to meet the infant's need to grow and survive. This is very important sentence. I will tell you why. Now you see about these oligosaccharides. An oligosaccharide is a saccharide polymer with small number of monosaccharides, about 10-15 maximum, sometimes less than simple sugars. Joined together, but unfortunately we cannot digest. Human gut cannot digest dietary oligosaccharide, so as the newborn. So when adults take oligosaccharide, which you have in lot of things what we eat in our diet, but that provides fiber to our stool content. Oligosaccharides are found only in primate milk. Non-primate milk has only very insignificant amount. Cow's milk has very insignificant amount of the oligosaccharide. Highest concentration of oligosaccharide is found only in human breast milk. Now people believe that this abundance of human milk oligosaccharide contribute towards the superiority of human species in this planet over all other humans, all other animals. So probably with the evolution, people believe that oligosaccharide play an important role in the human being, not just bioactive proteins, not just providing bacteria, food for bacteria, but something very different, unique. So they probably think that who we are today is because of oligosaccharides. It's probably because oligosaccharides provide the right microbiome in the gut. And the right microbiome is what really matters. Because you all know that the gut microbiome is actually 3 to 6 times of the total number of red cells that we have in our body. In our gut, you have 3 to 6 times of microbes. So that you can imagine our cells are much less than the amount of bacteria we have in our gut. So that is why the people now, there was an article in Nature to say that we should change our name, not to Homo sapiens, Homo bacterians. That is because part of us is actually our bacteria. Right. Now HMO categories, there are so many, there are more than 216 types of HMOs identified so far. But primarily there are 3 types of HMOs, what is called the non-fucosylated HMOs, which comprise about 41%. Then non-fucosylated neutral HMOs comes up to about 47%, and sialylated HMOs comes to about 12%, and the sialylated HMOs are generally acidic, whereas the major bulk, it is about 8% of oligosaccharides are neutral. And out of that, there are 2 very important things. It can almost about 50, more than 50% of them actually from this. There's a 2FL and what you call LN neotetros. That is non-fucosylated HMO. Neutral HMO. So they are the highest, but you have all the others, you see, and they have distinct functions, which I probably will tell you. Now, this is to show you how important this the breastfeeding. Now, this is actually a breastfed baby. You can see within in the first 5 days of giving breast milk, the microbiome shoots up, that is all bifidobacteria. The 90% of gut microbiota is actually bifidobacteria. And it constantly there till about 2-3 months, you can see it's teeming with bifidobacteria. But if you give formula feeds, you can see that the bifidobacteria just comes down and the other bacteria, bacteroidase, E. coli, they all started coming up. So this is why the proper gut microbiota, if you really want to have a proper gut microbiota, you have to start with breast milk and you have to continue breast milk. Now, this is another very important thing. With passage of time, the HMOs in human milk goes down. You can see this is, I told you there are 2 important things, which is called the 2FL. The other one is called LNNT. And these 2, you can see by the time the baby becomes 8 months, it is slowly coming down, and by about 1 year, it is becoming insignificant. So what does it mean? That means this HMOs has a role in the first 6 months of life of the newborn. And it, once the role is done, once the duty is done, that there is no need for you to have HMOs. So it will slowly come down. So what is the beauty, what is this function or the role? The role is to provide the proper gut microbiome in the first 6 months of life, because that provides the ultimately who you are. Because now we know the gut microbiome is the one which rules us, our diseases, our entire future, our life, when you grow, when you're getting ischemic heart disease, cholesterol, metabolic syndrome, and more than that. Now we know even autism, Alzheimer's disease, various other things now they know, and autoimmune diseases. Lot of things that we people never thought that now they know that it is because of this proper gut microbiome. And for an example to tell you that in irritable bowel syndrome, now what they do what you call fetal gut transplant. So microbiome transplant. You transplant the normal people fecal microbiome. And they found that it works 100%. Unfortunately, we cannot do that because nobody will like to take it orally or anything. So, but this preliminary studies were done. Actually, they have given a colonoscopy, and they have introduced to colonoscopy because it is the colon which is important in irritable bowel syndrome. Right. It's just example. Now, the other beauty of this HMO utilization by these bacteria is also different. Some of them actually metabolize within the cell. Some of these metabolize it outside and then it take into the cell, like bifidum. And B. longums, for example, takes it in and then metabolize inside. Some, of course, the other bacteria, when they metabolize that, you see the metabolite after this. Whatever the metabolites, when it is broken down into monosaccharide, they just absorb them. So there are various ways. And also, different oligosaccharide really nourishes different strains of bacteria. So important point for you to know. So that the gut microbiota of a newborn baby differ from mother to mother, baby to baby, because it all depends on the composition of oligosaccharide in the mother's breast milk. Different mothers geographically and in the same mother, from time to time, the oligosaccharide level changes, and as a result of that, the gut microbiome also changes to the needs of the baby. So the beauty of this HMO is that not only it provides food for the bacteria, it also decides what is my baby's gut microbiota should be. How much of B. longum to be there, how much of bifidum to be there, how much of lactobacillus to be there. So it's the mother decides, or the mother's breast milk decide, what should be the composition of gut microbiota of the baby. Right. I think I'll just bypass. This is just to show you potential beneficial if it have bifidobacterium and when you give breast milk, and we give the test. Test, of course, what they did was they put 2 fl. And then give the formula of it, and this is the control, they give only the formula. You can see when you give formula, the pathogenic bacteria is much more than the non-pathogenic, whereas if you give formula feeds with 2 fl and breastfeeding, you can see the gut microbiota is actually potentially beneficial microbes. Now this is another interesting story. I hope I have time. Half an hour. Now this is the most important part of this talk. You see, people wanted to see whether this the so-called oligosaccharide is actually the primarily for the bacteria for feeding. So what they did was they put galactose into the baby, to the mother, gave beta-galactose into the mother, which has been tagged with radioactive carbon, and then it went into the intestines, absorbed, went into the liver of the mother, then it has been biosyn, and then they reproduce, the mother produce HMOs, and that radioactive carbon containing HMO, they are in the breast milk. And then what happens is, so then we check the babies. I think that it is better for you to switch off your mic. Everybody can hear what you are saying. So the breastfeeding, so then you give the baby feeding, And then you see what happens to these radioactive oligosaccharides. And they found almost 90% of these HMOs are exceeded in the stools. And they found about 5% in the circulation in the baby's body, unchanged. And they found 5% eliminated in the urine. So then the question arose, if the function of these HMOs is only to provide this nutrition and whatever to the gut, why 10% is being absorbed into the body? So that means there is little more than gut function. We'll just discuss. This is the same thing in a different way. Now, what does HMO do apart from providing nutrition to the bacteria? Right. This is a very interesting thing. HMO actually does something very interesting. HMO, now you have, when a pathogenic bacteria gets into the body, there are what you call glycan receptors in the epithelium of the gut mucosa, and then it gets adhered to the glycan receptor. And then it gets into the tissues and it causes illness. So that is how all the infectious bacteria or virus or whatever gets into our body through the gut. Goes to the gut, get adherent to the glycan receptor, and then it gets into the body. So what HMO does is actually, it behaves like a decoy gut, the receptor, glycan receptor. So the bacteria get adherent to that. So when the bacteria get adherent to the HMO, then the bacteria cannot adhere to anything else, and that HMO, without doing any changes, just excrete out from the body. So the bacteria will not be able to adhere to the epithelium, which is called the decoying effect of the HMO. Not all HMOs, there are a lot of HMOs do this. This is called the decoy receptors. And then they do another thing. That is, when a bacteria comes, some of the oligosaccharide adhere to the glycan receptor, not allowing the pathogenic bacteria to get into that, so that they will be excreted out. So there is no way that the pathogenic bacteria can get into the tissues to cause illness. So there are two ways it modulates or protects the gut from entering into the body. Then the other important point is that when a newborn baby is actually born, they have a minimum TH1, but they have excess of TH2 cell activity. So you have to balance it. So when you give HMO, they found that HMO really increases the TH2 cell activity, so that it balances out the TH1 response and TH2. So what is the beauty of this? The beauty is that the atopic diseases, you don't get atopic diseases when you are giving when the milk has HMO. So when the breast milk, when you are feeding the baby, human milk has so much of HMOs that will really make the TH1 and TH2 balance, pro-inflammatory and inflammatory. There's a balance between the two, and that will lead to perfect immune balance. So in summary, what HMO does in the nutshell? It is a prebiotic, provides nutrition for the bacteria. It has an anti-adhesive, antimicrobial properties, has a decoy effect. Or it joins to the glycan receptor and modifies the epithelial cell. It is an immunomodulator, provide balance between the TH1 and TH2 immunity. And also, very recently, I told you now, 5% of oligosaccharide being absorbed into the circulation without changing. And they found recently, whenever there is an infection, this is called actually the leukocyte rolling and adhesion effect. So this HMOs when there is, say, for example, there is inflammatory tissue, the HMOs will really provide the chemotactic effect sort of thing, so that the all the leukocytes, the macrophages and dendritic cells will be taken near the inflammatory zone and will get adhered into that. So that is a new function of this the oligosaccharides in the human body. And finally, I'm going to talk a little bit about this brain development and providing nutrients. So in summary, ladies and gentlemen, about apart from the brain development, the HMO helped to establish a protective gut microbiota with predominant bifidobacteria. HMO blocks pathogens from doing harm by functioning as a soluble receptor analog to which the pathogens adhere. HMO strengthens the gut barrier function. I told you that it covers the glycan receptors. HMO also helped to educate the developing immune system, a proper immune system, by making Th1 and Th2 balance. Having said that, you see what a genius strategy. So mothers are recruiting another life form to babysit their babies, because that gut microbiota is the one which provides absolute protection for the newborn baby. Now, this is just to show you few slides in actual world how it works. Now, this is one I told you, there is one, the two most important oligosaccharide studies were 2FL and LNNT. Now, you see the Campylobacter diarrhea occurred less often in infants whose mother's milk contained higher levels of 2FL. Moderate to severe diarrhea of all causes occurred less often in infants whose mother's milk contained fucosylated, that's 2FL. Right? This is a protection from respiratory infection. You can see that with saline, with LNT and LST. You can see that the bronchial lavage, the streptopneumonia, when you are giving LNT and silated SLNT, reduce this pneumonia adherence. So 96 hours is almost zero. This is influenza, this is respiratory syncytial virus. You can see that when you're giving a higher dose of these LNTs, you can see there's a dramatic improvement. So this, there is no doubt that this oligosaccharides in vitro and in vivo and in other experiments has shown definitely protects the baby from gut infections, respiratory infections, and also allergies, which is with that slide. I don't have the Kaliumaki slide. I'm so sorry about it. And this is another very interesting side. The research was done with, again, 2FL. What happens is when you have a gram-negative, the bacterial sepsis, particularly the gram-negative septicemia, endotoxemia, the endotoxins produces all kinds of cytokines, and also the gram-negative bacteria is what you call LPS coverage. So those things open the gut barrier, and all the toxins will get into the tissue and poses what you call metabolic endotoxemia, and you get TLR activation, the toll-like receptors, and the toll-like receptors eventually get into the path and start producing interferons, interferon type 1 that is called beta and alpha. Then they start cascading and then provide pro-inflammatory cytokines, and then you get what you call shock syndrome. Excessive production of pro-inflammatory cytokines causes the so-called cytokine storm syndrome. Now we call it, but those days that is called shock syndrome. Right? So they found that these HMOs keep this tight junction tight, and so that the toxins, even they are produced in the gut, will not be able to go through into the tissues, so that there will be no metabolic endotoxemia. So human milk oligosaccharide composition predicts the risk of necrotizing enterocolitis in preterm infants. So it actually provides a protection for newborn infants. And in fact, there were a lot of studies going on where they give oligosaccharide rather than giving bacteria, because the initial studies on probiotics in necrotizing enterocolitis, because you cannot do the research for extremely preterm babies because their immunity is so little, so that when you give probiotic, they are living organisms that might cause sepsis. So all the studies initially had been done with babies more than 1,500 grams giving probiotics, whereas human milk oligosaccharides is a prebiotic, and people are doing a lot of trials and seeing benefits. So this is actually it's just a little important slide, because you can see when you are giving probiotics, you have a lot of what you call small chain fatty acid production. The small chain fatty acid production is very important, because that causes stools to be very soft. And also now we know that the small chain fatty acids are actually neurotransmitters. It transmitters signals to the gut, from the gut to the brain. So this is what actually that is, you know, this is when you disturb the gut microbiota, this is what happens, that is called gut microbial dysbiosis. You can see on the other side, that causes increased gut permeability, endotoxemia, diarrhea, then you have irritable bowel syndrome, liver disease, cardiovascular disease, and also now they know gut microbial dysbiosis causes more than this gut diseases, but other diseases like Alzheimer's disease and all what lot of diseases that you get in adulthood. So what is important is to have the balanced gut microbiota. So A, that you have to give breast milk. B, that you should not give antibiotics, particularly in the first 6 months of life. Should avoid giving antibiotics if necessary. Now, giving antibiotics just cough and cold is not the right thing to do. Right? So we have to have this, our ancient type of life, the normal diet, the probiotics. And you know, you just take a perfect diet without taking too much of drugs. And one of the worst drugs, of course, is actually the so-called what you give for gastritis. The proton pump inhibitors that really changes the gut microbiota. So this is just my last few slides. HMO provides what you call sialic acid as a metabolic product, and that is now is known to have actually increased synaptogenesis and transmission. And I will just go through a little bit. This is a lot of these slides about 2FLFS cognitive performance and improves learning. 2FL significantly improves the long-term growth of hippocampus and all that. This is just to show you it's so important. It's just a little slide that when you fed the babies with normal gut microbiota, this mouse, they have normal microglia. If you have germ-free if you breed them in a germ-free, or you give them antibiotics, and then when they did the studies, they found that their microglia in the brain is different. They are very long branches, and their segments are too much, and their function is not normal. So this is just to show you that the normal gut microbiota is actually helping the brain to develop. This is a foolproof evidence. So this is actually probably last one or two slides. This is how the gut talking to the brain. It's a cross link, you can see. Through the neuroendocrine signaling, and most of them are, as I told you, the so-called small chain fatty acids, the like acetates, then the propionates, butyrates, and all kinds of things. They are byproduct of this metabolism of gut microbiota. So this is just to show you all what the brain, the gut is, the microbiota is doing to the brain. And this is my last slide, ladies and gentlemen. This is how the gut brain talking to the head brain. The gut brain says, hello, head brain. So the head brain answers, yeah, Gatti, what's the matter? So the gut brain says, tell this man to stop this talk. It is almost 9 now. I'm hungry and want to have dinner. Thank you very much for listening.